Hello, everyone. We are calling this series Explained because the truth is, when it comes to the Bible, we could use some help explaining it, right? Like, it isn't easy to figure out sometimes. And if we're honest, we'd just say sometimes it's just plain confusing. Like, sometimes the Bible even creates more questions than it offers answers. And we're sometimes left feeling more uncertain than we were when we started. And because of that, we think, hey, the Bible could use some explaining. Now, if I had to guess, the very topic of this series is just a turn off to some of you. Like, maybe you could think of nothing more boring than to hear someone explain the Bible. It's an ancient text that feels sort of disconnected from current reality. In fact, you may be shocked that you're still even sitting there listening right now. Or maybe you don't like the idea of this series because you expect people at church to talk about how the Bible is the answer to all of your problems. And because of that, you should just do whatever it says you should do. Don't think, just do what the Bible says. But the truth is that having a just doing what it says view is super confusing because sometimes the Bible says to do some things that don't exactly make sense. Or maybe the topic of the Bible doesn't interest you because it's supposed to be helpful, but you've never experienced that. Maybe you've read certain verses and they really never came true for you or offered much help to your real life problems. And apparently people talk about how useful and helpful the Bible is. But for many of us, that's just hard to see. Like, how is something written so long ago helpful to my life right now? And why does it have to be so complicated to understand? So if the Bible feels irrelevant to your current state of life and too confusing to understand and hasn't proven helpful in the past, then why is it such a big deal for people who follow Jesus to read? And what exactly are we missing if we don't read it? Well, today I want to look at a verse in the Bible that might help us have a better understanding of why the Bible is helpful for us to read as Jesus followers. And it's a verse found tucked in a letter that the Apostle Paul wrote to Timothy. Now, Paul was like a mentor or a coach to Timothy, who was much younger than Paul. And Timothy was charged to help lead and develop Jesus followers in the early church. And that's why Paul would send letters to Timothy, kind of instructing him on what to do when it came to leading the church. Paul was sort of like Timothy's Yoda, okay? Now, when Paul penned these words to Timothy, he was in prison, and because of the state of Rome at the time, his life was likely nearing the end. Nero, who ruled Rome at the time, was corrupt and cruel, and he was known for persecuting and killing Christians. And with that in mind, Paul likely felt like his life could end at any moment. And I imagine that Paul wrote with a certain pressure or urgency to make sure that Timothy would be fully prepared to lead without him around. And I think that's why Paul wrote to Timothy about the things that mattered most. These were things that he wanted to make sure Timothy understood, things that needed to survive and live on past the reign of Nero, past his own life. They needed to survive for years to come. So Paul writes to Timothy and says this: "All scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness." Now, because Paul didn't know that what he was writing would later be considered scripture or the Bible, he is referring to what would have been scripture at the time he wrote the letter. He is referring to the Jewish scripture. The Jewish scripture is what we call the Old Testament, which included the writings of the law, the history of the people of Israel as they went from one man to a nation, the message from the prophets, and the poems and songs from their history. All of this, Paul is saying, is God-breathed. All of this, Paul is saying, is useful. It's much needed. Meaning, hey, look, this stuff matters. It's important. He wanted to make sure that Timothy understood that this scripture is part of who we are and part of where we came from. But it will also help us in where we are going as followers of Jesus. And hey, listen, that sounds nice, but the language still sounds sort of confusing. I mean, how exactly does scripture do this? And what exactly does God breathe even mean? And what does it have to do with anything? Is that just a fancy way of saying God said it? Well, this is the only time in the New Testament that this phrase, God breathed, is used. So it's hard to know exactly. Nowhere else in the New Testament does God breathe into something. But we do know this. At the start of the whole Bible, in the very first document of the Old Testament, we read about how God breathed life into humans. And when God breathed life into humans, humans became alive. Then the Lord God formed a man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils, which is a little strange, but the breath of life, and the man became a living being. See, when God breathes, life follows. And that's what should get our attention. Maybe we can apply that to what it means for God to breathe into Scripture. If God breathes life into humans, then that means that God's words found in the Bible, they bring life as well. All Scripture is God-breathed. That's what makes what we read and memorize and study important. God breathed into the words of the Bible, and he breathed into you. God's breath and God's words have always brought life. The problem is we assume the opposite. We assume God breathed life into us, but his God-breathed words are lifeless and boring and useless, but they were never ever meant to be that. See, the same God who spoke through the writers of Scripture can speak life to you and through you. That's why the Bible is so important to read. That's how the Bible works. God's Spirit working through the people who wrote it, and God's Spirit working through you, his child, as you read it, to better help you know how to live. So, is the Bible made of words on a page? Sure, but it's not like any old words on any old page. There is something that makes the words in the Bible different than any other document ever written. As you read, study, or memorize what it says, the breath of God in the text will move in your God-breathed spirit and instruct you, inspire you, and challenge you. And see, Paul knew this. He knew for the message of Christianity to keep going, to last longer than his life did, he had to make sure people knew where to go to find God at work, to find God bringing life. And Paul knew that the best place to see God at work was in his word. So what do we do with all this? Where do we go from here? How do we get this God-breathed life out of the Bible and into our lives? Well, to begin, we need to change the way we see the Bible, to change why we read the Bible. We need to decide to read the Bible not because it gives us answers, not because it's an instruction manual, but because it's where we find and connect with God. We read the Bible because we can find God there. He is in the words and in the pages. And because God breathed life into us, he wants us to experience an abundant life here. And reading the words he breathed into life helps us discover that life. And that's why when it comes to the Bible, we read it because God is in it. We read it because God is in it. Because God's Spirit is in the words and God's Spirit is in you. It's important to get God's words in you. Reading God's words has the potential to breathe more life into you. It has the potential to bring encouragement when you feel down, to bring wisdom when you aren't sure how to think about or handle something, to bring understanding when you have a hard time knowing how to love someone. All of those things are life-giving, and all of those things make you better at life. Getting God's words in you happens by memorizing the words, and it's one of the things in life that may not seem useful or helpful until you try it. And even though you have the potential to always have a copy of the Bible tucked in your back pocket, thanks to your phone, there is something powerful about having it tucked into your mind and heart. You don't have to open anything, but your mind, when you feel down, lost, or unsure, the Spirit of God in you connects with the Spirit of God in the words of the Bible. And that's why I want you to try memorizing something this week. Simply pick a passage that stands out to you. You can do this with a group of friends or other people you know. Say it, write it, sing it, or do whatever you have to do over and over until you know it by heart. And maybe it will be obviously useful right away, maybe not. Either way, over time, pay attention to how the verse you memorize helps you make decisions, helps you remember what's important, or helps you feel connected to your Heavenly Father. See, here's another benefit. Not only does God's words have the power to breathe life into you, but it has the power to breathe life into others through you. When you have God's Spirit in you and God's Word in you, it's more likely to come out of you. When your friend faces something difficult or when your sibling feels down, you have the power to bring life to whatever they're feeling by bringing up something you remember from God's Word. And that's why the Bible is helpful and useful. That's why it's important. And maybe that's why Paul wrote so strongly to tell Timothy about it. God isn't only found in the Bible, but he is found uniquely in the Bible. And he can impact your life in unique ways when you read and memorize the Bible. You'll discover things about God and Scripture that you won't necessarily be able to find anywhere else. It's worth putting in the time and then being persistent to memorize the words to allow God's Spirit in Scripture to teach you and challenge you and inspire you. But here's the deal. Reading a document written thousands of years ago from a different time, from a different culture, with confusing details and various forms of literature matched together with no straight timeline isn't easy. Oftentimes it can feel like work. It doesn't feel like life. It feels like a job. It's not immediate, but that's okay. Getting to know God, like getting to know anyone else, is a process. But as you read, I think you will discover what Paul described to Timothy. You will discover the power it has to breathe life. You will discover that God's breath is in the text and it's in you and I. You will discover that the more you read the Bible, the more you find God in it. And this is why this is so important for you right now. As high schoolers, you are in a unique stage of life where you are mature enough and independent enough to establish a faith of your own. Not a faith of your parents or grandparents or student leaders, but a real faith that is yours. And real mature faith doesn't happen without spending time getting to know the God found tucked into the stories and words found in the Bible. A real personal grown-up faith happens when you pick up the Bible and discover it for yourself. And that is what I want for you. The truth is, there are a bunch of moments every day when I feel like I need some life breathed into me. And maybe you feel that way too. Life is hectic. Sometimes it feels like our heads are barely above water. And more often than I realize, that breath of fresh air we need, that life we need, is found in the words of the Bible. The words we look up and read right then, or the words we know because we have memorized them and tucked them away. As somebody who has known Jesus and followed him for a long time, I can tell you that I know him differently because of what I found in the Bible. I read the Bible because God is in it, and I want to know him better, and I want that for you as well.